En el imaginario popular, las víctimas del tráfico sexual en Estados Unidos son mujeres extranjeras traídas a la fuerza.
They all have the same notion that sex trafficking looks like the movie Taken.
Pero la realidad muestra que muchas son mujeres nacidas y criadas en Estados Unidos.
Losing my mother was kind of like where things took a turn for the worse.
We're heading for a safe house that cares for child victims of sex trafficking.
These kids that are being identified at age 12 and 13 and 14 desperately need help now.
You okay?
Explotadas en las calles, por internet, en hoteles, en casas.
I was 15 when I was out here. Rosie was 15 when she was out here.
Muchas son esclavizadas con drogas y marcadas como ganado.
He decided to put two devils having sex on my back. Thought it would be funny, thought it would be cute.
La visión tradicional sobre la prostitución está empezando a cambiar en Ohio.
I believe that prostitution is the most misunderstood criminal enterprise in America right now.
Put her on the right path.
Lo novedoso es cómo tratan a las víctimas y está funcionando.
I'm happy I'm here, but not here.
Están redefiniendo qué es el tráfico sexual y cómo escapar de él.
I feel like I'm taking my body back.
La BBC acompañó a tres sobrevivientes en Columbus, Ohio.
Oh my gosh. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Ah! Oh, son of a butthead. Oh. I can't believe this is getting covered up right now. I never in my life thought that this was going to be able to happen.
Bajo este dibujo está tatuado el nombre de un exnovio, un hombre mayor que se hacía cargo de ella a cambio de favores sexuales.
When I was like 19 years old, I got into a relationship with this guy. We lived two completely different lifestyles. I wasn't in love with him. He gave me what I wanted as long as I did what he wanted. So the tattoo was just like a sign of loyalty to him, property, reassurance, you know, because it's permanent, it's forever.
Era una señal de lo que vendría. Su mano, tatuada con una rosa, esconde la marca de una familia de traficantes sexuales.
The branding on my hand is a Spanish word, it's punta, and it can mean three different things in Spanish, which is hoe, whore, or the B word. Every morning when I would wake up, there would be somebody else in the bed with me, and I couldn't tell you what happened the night before. I still don't even know. Every single family member had did whatever they wanted to do. Like I said, because I would get so drunk, I would black out. But that was another way of me trying to escape reality, escape my feelings, escape the life that I was living, just being in survival mode. It was always about survival mode. Well, you got to completely rebuild yourself up. To love yourself is one of the hardest things to do because for your biggest resentment is towards yourself, and your hardest person to forgive is yourself. So when you conquer that and you overcome that, little things like that tattoo, that memory will fade away. My stepdad was an alcoholic and kind of grew up in like a violent home. My mother had a lot of health problems and she was prescribed a lot of pain medication. I woke up getting ready for school one day and found her dead, and she had shot herself due to this disease. She was going through withdrawals and she took her own life because of it. I was mad at the world, mad at everyone. Losing my mother was kind of like where things took a turn for the worst, and I started seeking out other ways, and that's when using drugs, you know, I started experimenting with marijuana and ecstasy really young. I remember one of my boyfriends, he sold drugs, and I started using pain pills, and I still didn't even realize that I was going down like the same path as my mother, being addicted to pain medication. By the age of 19, I was using heroin, and I didn't know nothing, know what it was about. I just knew I loved the way that I felt when I did it. And the men that I always, you know, it was abusive relationships, that became my norm. I grew up watching my mother, you know, get beat, and I always said I would never let a man put his hands on me, but it didn't matter. He could beat me till my face turned blue, but if he told me he was sorry and he told me that he loved me, I fed off of that more. Before I even met a pimp, the sex trafficking was already happening because people have this image of like this man in a suit selling these women, like what you see on TVs, and that's not the case. Really, it's happening in your backyard. It could be a family member, it can be a boyfriend. Living in Nebraska and continuing to hang around that family, it's not like they held my hand down to do that, but I felt like I belonged and like I was somebody. And at the time, I had no self-worth or self-love for myself, so that was okay.
Al igual que los antiguos dueños de esclavos, muchos traficantes marcan a sus mujeres. Las obligan a tatuarse para probar su lealtad. Eso es lo que ha inspirado a Survivors Inc., una ONG creada por Jennifer Kempton, una sobreviviente del tráfico sexual. Tatuadores como Mike Prickett cubren estas marcas, así como otras huellas físicas del tráfico, sin costo alguno para las mujeres. Jennifer murió hace 2 años, pero Mike continúa con el trabajo que ella empezó hace 4.
So when you got started, how often were you doing cover-ups for these women?
At least once a week. That's been kind of eye-opening. Human trafficking was one of those things that was never really on my radar. It was something that you saw on the news that happened in other countries, not in your backyard. So kind of recognizing that was a little bit rougher than what I had anticipated, thinking, you know, I have sisters, I have a daughter, I have a strong wife, like it could have been any of them at some time, you know.
Have you noticed any trends in the past 4 years with the types of brandings that are getting covered?
Probably the last like year and a half, 2 years, things have been a lot bigger. When I first started, they were maybe softball size. Now I get more stuff like this that takes 2 to 4 or 5 sessions than just one quick one. That's it. You're a champ. That was a lot of lines.
Tomará unas sesiones más hasta que el nuevo tatuaje esté terminado, pero el dibujo está hecho.
That looks so good. Thank you. You can't even see it. No, oh my God. Get a hug. I appreciate you.
Oh, no problem. I'm glad that you got it done.
La mayoría de la gente cree que las víctimas del tráfico sexual son llevadas a Estados Unidos desde lugares como Sudamérica o Asia. Si bien eso pasa, es bastante raro. El Departamento de Justicia dice que más del 80% de las víctimas nacieron y crecieron, de hecho, en Estados Unidos. Y Ohio es uno de los peores en este sentido. Columbus está en el medio de Estados Unidos, en una intersección de carreteras muy transitadas que conectan el norte con el sur y el este con el oeste. Pero muchas trabajadoras han sido traficadas simplemente dentro de sus propios barrios.
We're heading for a safe house that cares for child victims of sex trafficking, and apparently they're seeing a growing demand for beds and have given us rare access to see exactly why more and more girls are caught up in this crisis.
Esto es Grace Heaven. Cuando llegamos, las chicas estaban haciendo un curso por internet en un aula. Además de estudiar, participan en sesiones de terapia, hacen actividades divertidas y viajes. Todo lo que pueda devolverles su infancia.
So we can't identify the exterior of this place or the girls that occupy it, so I'm going to give you a little tour. Here we've got games, 2 shelves of it. There are coloring in books. I guess it kind of gives you a sense of just how young these girls are. And then here we've got the living room space. Moving into the bedroom. This bedroom looks like any girl's bedroom. This could have been my bedroom. Lots of self-affirmations on the wall. What I find quite shocking is that there's a picture of an ultrasound on the board. So there's a girl in here that's expecting.
Algunas de estas niñas tienen tan solo 12 años y por lo general están aquí 8 meses hasta que les encuentran un nuevo hogar. Scott Arnold es el encargado de este centro.
We like it here.
It feels like a real home.
That is part of what we're after. We're trying to create as much as we can, not an institutional place. Most of the young people that come to us, well, really all, come either through a local county court or a children's services agency.
Can you tell me a bit about the trend, about whether this is a growing problem?
The need, I think, is growing in dramatic ways, in part because we're rethinking what it means to be a sex trafficked young person.
Cerca de 3,000 niñas menores de edad están en riesgo de ser traficadas cada año en Ohio. Los recursos están agotados. Aquí hay 8 niñas. Están planeando triplicar la capacidad, pero incluso así, eso no sería suficiente.
How do these children get trafficked in the first place?
It can be a mom who frequently can be drug addicted and needs some resources financially to pay for her drug addiction. It can also be moms who bring a man into their home, whether it's the father or more often than not a boyfriend, who begins to molest the child, and then things go from there. Another typical path would be a young person who is in relational strain with their family. And so that kid is at risk to an older man that shows up in her life and begins to act and behave like he's romantically interested, and then other men start being brought in and the pressure starts being put on the girl. Well, I've done all these things for you and I love you, why won't you do this for me? And then there's another subset that I would say, and that is runaway kids. They'll stop and roll down the window. Do you have a place to live? Are you okay? Can I buy you a meal? And so they're preyed on aggressively. These kids that are being identified at age 12 and 13 and 14 desperately need help now. Nearly every prostitute that we see was a child once that was trafficked against her will and manipulated into a life and then has felt trapped and doesn't find an off-ramp to that life frequently until their life is completely destroyed. That is what prostitution is. And the start of that is what human trafficking is. When you see it that way, suddenly you're horrified at a whole new level.
Holly es una sobreviviente del tráfico sexual. Junto a su hermana menor, Rosie, nos muestra su barrio.
I moved to Columbus when I was 15 to live with my real mother, which is like one of the worst decisions of my life, because within 2 weeks of being here in Columbus with my real mother, we were using drugs together. Within a month of being here in Columbus, we were prostituting together.
Holly recuperó su vida hace 4 años y está viviendo cerca de las mismas calles donde estuvo cautiva por 17 años.
And this is where you grew up?
Yeah, this is my stepdad's house.
Okay.
Well, I guess I guess he's my stepdad, like, because he was there for, like, most of it, but, like, he was my mom's sugar daddy. I don't know if you know what that term is, but, like, an older man that takes care of you.
Yeah.
And, like, this is where she brought us to.
Right.
Yeah.
And how many, who lived here then at the time?
At the time it was me, it was her, it was him, it mm-hmm. was his 2 sons.
Mm-hmm.
Just a lot of chaos and dysfunction.
Yikes.
Yeah.
How long were you here?
He was a trick too of ours.
Yeah.
Like, I think he had sex with all of us. Mm-hmm. Me, my sister, my other sister.
I used to have sex with him, like, every month around the first of the month when he'd get his check.
God, I can't imagine.
I used to be angry, mm-hmm. but I'm not so angry anymore. Like, it doesn't serve a purpose. It just keeps me, like, bound up inside. So, like, you kind of just forgive and move forward with your life.
Have you ever considered, like, reporting them, or?
I don't think that would do any justice. Like, I don't know. He's, like, in his 80s. He's, like, on his deathbed.
Rosie siguió un camino similar de drogas y abuso.
The only time I would see my sister is when I would come out on outreach. So that first time I stopped, I didn't know it was her. I just had said, hey, there's a girl sleeping in a little cubby hole. Can we stop? And as we got closer and she stood up and I was like, hey, would you like a hygiene bag and a lunch? She got up and she approached and I was like, oh my God, that's my sister. And like tears just started flowing. Like I was so devastated. Like I hadn't seen her in a year and a half. And I felt like I had caused this because like I, you know, my mother brought me into the lifestyle. I was in the lifestyle and like I probably made it look really glamorous and I brought her into the lifestyle and I brought her into her own living hell.
Por más de un año, Holly visitó a Rosie hasta que se escapó y comenzó su recuperación.
Looking at that spot now and where you were at, how does that make you feel?
I felt alone, I felt trapped, and I honestly thought that I wasn't going to make it out the lifestyle. I thought that I was going to die out here on these streets.
My mother gave birth to me when she was 16 years old. She gave me to my grandparents, who were also alcoholic and smoked marijuana. I can remember being verbally and physically abused by my grandparents, sexually abused by other members of my family, all before the age of 5. I remember being called like a hooker, a whore, things like that, saying I was worthless and just like my mother, before I even knew what any of these things meant. I excelled in school. It was an escape from my reality. I remember being in the first grade and the teacher had the same last name as me, and I used to pretend she was my mother because I longed for a relationship with my mother. I would only get remnants of her. My birthday is Christmas Day, so I'm sitting by the window waiting because she promised me she was coming on Christmas Day to see me with presents, and I remember staring out of the window and she never showed up. At about age 12, I was allowed to smoke marijuana in the home. About age 15, I was in a group home. I got in trouble with the group home, and I decided I was going to come up here and live with my real mother. Within 2 weeks of being here in Columbus, I'm smoking crack cocaine with my mother. And within a month of being here, I'm prostituting with my mother. I was vulnerable, I was exposed. My mother was benefiting from my exploitation. So there was this guy who kept saying, like, come join my team. It looked glamorous. Like, the rap industry depicts like this god. It looked like he took care of them, like they all had nice clothes, a place to stay, and I entered into hell. He used to have this saying, like, you signed on the dotted line, you owe me your life. And I thought it was cute or funny or just a joke, but he meant it. I remember walking into another drug house and spending $20 there, and like, him finding out and him beating me up. Like, they beat me with a crock pot lid until it broke over my head. And then he told me to go upstairs and take a shower and get cleaned up and go get some money. And that's exactly what I did because I feared for my life. He would take me to the brink of thinking he was going to kill me, and then he would make it all better with drugs or affection or telling me he was sorry. By the time I was 17 or 18, I had been raped more times than I can count. I had been kidnapped, I had been held hostage. I've been stabbed, I've been shot at. I just wanted to be normal. Like, I wanted to be a nurse. I wanted a life, I wanted a family. And I feel that was stolen from me at a very young age. I didn't have that opportunity. I had like this trauma bond to him. Like, I felt like he took care of me, even though like he would beat me and then I'd go upstairs and go to sleep and I'd wake up to him raping me. Like, I felt attached to him because I felt like he cared for me. The one guy like marked most of his girls with either royalty is loyalty or love is loyalty. There was a surplus of women under one house. Sometimes as many as 20 would be working for one pimp. It's not uncommon for most of us to bear some sort of branding from his signia, like whether it be for his gang or whatever he wants, like to put his name on you or some type of something. Everybody knows, like, you're his bitch. He ended up going to prison for federal drug trafficking. I ended up going to prison for drug possession because I was his mule. So I started attending this group and I never identified as a human trafficking victim. And like all these things that these abusers and traffickers are doing to their victims, I identified. Like it was like a light clicked on for me. And the fog was removed from my eyes and I was able to make a choice. I was able to choose to live and not allow this to happen to me, and I empowered myself.
Las sobrevivientes del tráfico son por lo general desestimadas como criminales, adictas y vagabundas. Peor aún, muchos ven a la prostitución como una elección de vida. Pero aquí, en Columbus, estas opiniones están cambiando.
We're here at the Franklin County Court where they've spearheaded a new program which helps victims of sex trafficking get back on the road to recovery.
Roxanne! Hi, Roxanne.
Hi, guys.
Hi.
It's good to see you.
I know a lot of you.
Yeah. We're happy you're here.
Yeah. I'm not. I mean, I'm happy I'm here, but not here.
Right.
They get that.
Let me tell you how special you are, right? I'm so proud of you for making your way here and saying, hey, I'm ready. You know? I mean, I'm just loving that right now.
Este es un tribunal CACH, las siglas en inglés de Cambia Acciones para Cambiar Hábitos. Es un programa que acoge a mujeres encarceladas por prostitución o por crímenes cometidos para su traficante. El programa las redefine como víctimas y les ofrece un camino para recuperarse. Melissa viene aquí y aquí también es donde Holly logró recuperarse. Ahora es el turno de Rosie. Son 2 años de libertad condicional en un hogar y tratamiento para las adicciones y terapia. El programa fue ideado por el juez Paul Herbert.
I was in arraignment court, which is a court where everyone who's in jail, and we set bonds on them. And they changed the law in domestic violence to where I had to see and hear every domestic violence case. I didn't like it at all because I was had to hear all these horrible things. But I'd see these victims kind of lost, scared, and the betrayal. So this was going on. And the sheriff brought the next defendant out on the wall. And I looked up and it was a woman. And she looked exactly like one of these victims of domestic violence. I'm like, why would I get that feel? You know, it's a prisoner. It's a defendant. And she's standing there in handcuffs, but she had that same look about her and those same similar injuries. Mm-hmm. And I looked down at the file and it said prostitute. And I thought, how could a prostitute ever look like a domestic violence victim? I mean, now I look back and think that's dumb. And I found out some staggering statistics that the world has hidden from us.
De más de 1,000 mujeres arrestadas por prostitución en Columbus, Herbert descubrió que 900 de ellas eran víctimas de tráfico.
What do we have here? We have a new case,
yes,
of obstructing,
yes,
a heinous obstructing official business.
Yes.
And then you're on probation, is it, for this other case?
Yes.
And so what you're basically saying is you want me to be your judge now.
Yes.
Is that true?
Yes.
But you don't know me very well, do you?
Yes, I do.
Okay.
From a long, long time
What's
ago.
My nickname?
Hang 'em
high, Herbert. I believe that prostitution is the most misunderstood criminal enterprise in America right now. It's supposed to be the world's oldest profession. So I believe that it's really the world's oldest oppression of women and girls and other vulnerable populations. You don't need chains like the movies. You're giving them a cell phone, you know where they are, you know, you're controlling their every movement. You mix in physical and sexual violence. It's like prisoner of war tactics.
Los fondos de CACH son limitados. Por eso, antes de ser aceptadas, las mujeres deben mostrar su voluntad de cambiar.
Why don't you tell me, like, why you want to be in the CACH court, if you don't mind?
Well, because first off, my sister Kim told me how great it was. I was coming with Safe Harbor House.
Over in Springfield.
Yes. And that's where I got all my clean time. That's how I got the start of my clean time in my new life. And I just want to get back to that again.
And guess what? I'm going to accept you in the CACH court.
Se trata obviamente de una corte poco convencional que le permite a las mujeres empoderarse y apoyarse.
I have the gavel and the robe and I get court started and I do the legal things, but then I sort of step back and let the women heal each other, help heal each other. Tell her, like, what's the secret to success there? Put her on the right path, okay? So I think you'll be seeing her soon, so like, help her out.
It's a pretty structured environment, but for a lot of us, that's what we need. For real, we don't have to worry about food, we don't have to worry about a place to lay. We have a really nice house, it's beautiful. You know, we have an area out back with tables and swings, and it's really a nice place, and they really care about you.
And we love you!
You're gonna get mad, and you're gonna wanna leave, and all I can say is any of us, at any given time, are here for you.
Absolutely.
Because since you signed those papers, you are now officially our sister. Mm-hmm. And we are going to love you until you absolutely love yourself.
Absolutely.
Coming into the Catch Court has allowed me to open up, trust the judge, trust Catch staff. You know what I mean? Because that misconception that they're out to get me, or if I mess up, if I'm not perfect, that I'm going to go to jail. I remember what it felt like to leave and go back out there on them streets and go back to that old stuff. And I'm like, oh my God, I got to get out of this. I got to get back to this program.
I'm going to be your official welcome committee. And I'm going to welcome she you will. So good.
By the time the handcuffs come off, we're hoping that she looks forward to coming to court and being part of that camaraderie and that squad.
Las reglas son estrictas. Para alejarlas de las malas influencias, las llevan a un hogar refugio, lejos de sus traficantes. El tratamiento para la adicción y el trauma es riguroso.
A woman is using drugs to medicate her trauma. Once you settle that trauma down, they don't want to use drugs anymore. The trauma is at the root of their drug addiction, rather than their drug addiction is driving everything.
A Roxanne también le ofrecerán un trabajo. Catch trabaja con una empresa que solo emplea sobrevivientes del tráfico sexual. Es muy difícil para las mujeres con un récord criminal encontrar trabajo. Por eso este esquema es clave para su rehabilitación. Para las marcas en el cuerpo, Roxanne puede acudir a Survivors Inc. y también a una clínica que quita los tatuajes. Esta mujer lo hizo.
In 2 months, I'll have to go back and they'll just get what they miss. But it's really simple and it's not very painful. I'm 50 years old and I'm trying to present myself in a different way now. Mm-hmm. And it was a struggle for me, you know, like I have this big, ugly reminder of my past, but then do I just get a bigger tattoo to cover it up, you know? So I was really grateful for the opportunity to be able to do this. So I could just erase my past and I'll have to worry about it.
That is like deep stuff, girl.
Hay evidencia de que el programa está funcionando. Mientras que el promedio nacional de reincidencia criminal es del 80%, el Tribunal Catch tiene un índice de menos del 30%. Ahorra dinero y, algo más importante aún, salva vidas. Otros estados como Indiana e Illinois lo están evaluando. El modelo ya fue adoptado en 3 ciudades en Ohio. Para ver cómo funciona, Elaine Young de la BBC se unió a un grupo de voluntarias. Por 4 años han estado entregando ayuda a posibles víctimas de tráfico sexual.
How many boxes have you got here then?
We've got 4 boxes. We've got like 19 bags, probably like 20 plus lunches.
Could you give me a sense of like what we've got in these care packages?
A little snack, peanut butter and jelly sandwich, some fresh carrots. Let's see what else is in here. Ooh, nice, a Cheryl's cookie. Then we have our hygiene bags. Toothbrush, toothpaste, hand cream, condoms. These are a big necessity. Sometimes these are the most expensive thing on the item list.
Right.
Deodorant, comb, feminine hygiene products. Mm-hmm. We've been pretty successful in people supporting us because we haven't missed a Sunday in almost 4 years.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah.
Every Sunday.
Every Sunday, no matter what, 6 o'clock, we're out.
And I see you're joined by a sister now as well.
Absolutely. We're matching today.
Like, yeah, you are. I love the outfits. Yeah, you both look beautiful. Yeah.
Let's do it.
So tell me about the area that we're going around today then.
A lot of the houses are like depleted homes. I would say you would find a drug house on every corner, if not 2 or 3 on every corner.
Wow.
Brothels or houses where women are trafficked out of. Hey, would you like a hygiene bag and a lunch? Yeah. It's kind of hot out here today, right?
Yes.
There's a water in there and some snacks and stuff. Yeah. Be safe, okay? No
problem. En los últimos años ha habido un aumento en el número de mujeres en la calle. Puede ser por varias razones. Se sabe que el cierre de moteles vinculados al tráfico sexual ha hecho que el problema se traslade a otra parte. Además, la unidad de Columbus a cargo de la prostitución está reorganizándose. Se desarmó a comienzos de año después de que se descubrió que un policía extorsionaba a mujeres a cambio de sexo. Eso significa que hay menos policías en las calles.
Friend, how are you? Here's lunches. Huh? Will you hand one to her? One of those are for her. And then, oh, you want the little notebook one? Ooh, this has got some Bath and Body Works stuff in there.
How are you doing? I miss you. I have lost a lot of weight. Be safe. I love you. Bye, guys. She's been through a lot. She's transgender as well. So if she's picked up and somebody realizes this, she's raped her, beat her, thrown her out somewhere far away. I have a soft spot in my heart for her because we were out here together for quite some time, mm-hmm. and we helped each other, like, through our tough times. Like, we've cried with each other, we've showered with each other, like, mm-hmm. like her, trying to hurry and get ready, like, so we can get out in time. It's just, we've been through a lot together.
How does it feel for you to have recovered and, you know, still see her out here?
It's really hard to walk away. Yeah. Like, I wish I could put her in the car and take her with me, but I know that that's not realistic right now, not until she's ready, not until something changes for her.
Esto es solo una muestra de cómo venden a las mujeres. Ahora todo se hace por internet. El año pasado, el FBI cerró un mercado online de tráfico sexual. Pero el problema solo cambia de sitio. Puedes encontrar a estas mujeres en servicios de acompañamiento, redes sociales e incluso en los clasificados.
You want a hygiene bag and lunch? I haven't seen you in a long time.
La BBC pudo ver muchas mujeres deambulando, sedadas por el efecto de las drogas.
She's probably been up for a few days without sleep, maybe like two or three, and that's why she's moving around like that.
Okay.
She's probably on crack and heroin. Did you see? I seen track marks on her arm.
Lejos de estas zonas deprimidas, el tráfico ocurre, pero se ve diferente. A las mujeres se las suele mantener dentro. Hoteles y casinos atraen esta actividad, sobre todo en grandes eventos deportivos.
Friend, I've seen you and you know I have to come back. I love you, friend. How are you? You look beautiful. You're beautiful. Look, look who's in the back.
Hi, Rosie.
Check that out, right?
Oh, that's so cool.
Isn't it crazy? Please, you look tired, friend. You tired?
Yeah.
Please be careful. I love you.
Be safe. I love you.
She's Isn't lovely. She? She's always so happy. But like, yeah. even in hard times, you got to keep a smile on your face, you know?
How long have you known her for?
Oh God, 10 years.
Really?
Oh yeah, a long time. It's really hard to walk away. Not just her, a lot of them. Like, because I know what it's like to be desolate. I know what it's like to feel hopeless.
La cantidad de mujeres en la calle es sorprendente, una cantidad desproporcionada en comparación con la población de 900.000 habitantes de Columbus. Más sorprendente aún es los jóvenes, que parecen muchas.
I did have lunches, but I ran out of lunches. Oh, I love your little star. You're beautiful. That girl was maybe like 16 or 17. She didn't look very old.
Just teenagers. When these girls are brought in, what would you say is the average amount of time in terms of months or years that they're kept in that life?
Sometimes it doesn't end. Sometimes you die out here.
El tráfico sexual es la forma más común de tráfico humano y es extremadamente lucrativo. Mueve globalmente 100,000 millones de dólares al año y atrapa a 4,8 millones de personas. ¿Pero cómo alguien se vuelve traficante? ¿Qué los lleva a ello? La BBC visitó una prisión en Ohio para tratar de entender el fenómeno.
Jeffrey Bagley has been sentenced to 10 years. He ran a really prolific sex trafficking ring. So it'd be really fascinating to see what he has to say and why he's agreed to do this interview.
Después de 17 meses de investigación, Jeffrey Bagley fue condenado en 2019 junto con Curtis Gossett. Ambos traficaron a decenas de mujeres usando drogas para controlarlas.
I worked for Curtis, British Construction Company, and was just getting paid in drugs with a free house to live in, you know. And then that's when he came to me and asked me if I wanted to change jobs. And I was like, yeah, what do I got to do? And all I had to do was just drive a female to out calls, to hotels or whatever, and make sure she was safe. And then that's pretty much when it all started.
Para ellos fue fácil reclutar a las mujeres desde la cárcel.
In our city, there's a magazine that comes out you can buy at the corner stores that has people go to jail for that week and what their charges are. And if any of them were soliciting, you know, we would send them to the jail and they'd talk to them and ask them if they wanted to come work for us, and we would bond them out. So that's where the recruiting from the jails came in at.
So how much money were these women making you?
Each girl would be like anywhere from $1,000 to $1,500 a day, each girl.
Wow. And how many clients would they be seeing on average every day?
Well, in the beginning, when I was there driving some of them to their calls, we had a couple girls that would see 3 or 4 a day.
So in what range then? So from 3 or 4 to?
12. Within about a year, it got really big, where we had seen almost about $750,000, like quick. In 2017, I made $450,000 myself. I would never make that anywhere else.
But you're dealing with humans. You're not dealing right. with just money coming in and out. I mean, that could have been your daughter. You sound, make it sound so transactional, which I'm a little astounded by, I guess. Do you understand that kind of reaction that I have?
I mean, but that's just how it was for so long. It was just normal. That was just normal.
Were you sorry that you got caught, or were you sorry for what happened?
I mean, yeah, I'm sorry I got caught, you know, because, man, my kids was being taken care of very, very well, you know. Now I'm in here, and it's over. I can't do nothing now at all. You know, they get $4.50 a month now. That's it.
Do you have any remorse for what you did to the women?
Yeah and no, but because... I was, you know, pretty much in the same boat they was in, you know. I was getting high just like they were, you know, and I did for the drugs just like they did, because they wouldn't be, you know, selling themselves if they wasn't, you know, on drugs themselves. So, I mean, I don't know, really. You know, I haven't really thought about that.
Jen se está tatuando la pierna derecha. Es el último recordatorio visible de su pasado. Bajo este faro hay heridas de cuando casi perdió su pierna por las drogas cuando estaba siendo traficada.
The first one I was with for a few months. He got 200 years because he was doing it to other girls in a few different states.
Jen tiene varias marcas en su cuerpo. La peor está en su espalda.
I've seen a lot of stuff, but I've never had an existing tattoo make my heart sink. And that one did it. Ready?
Yep.
All right, this is one of those long lines, okay?
Okay. Oh my gosh. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. To make more money, I guess, he decided to put 2 devils having sex on my back. Thought it would be funny, thought it'd be cute. So I had devils on each shoulder. I had a boy devil, a girl devil. When I got with my son's father, that's really when everything changed. My whole life changed. Larry was actually 6 months younger than my dad. I mean, I just remember my son crying and I'm crying, and his brother had some Percocets. And he's like, here, you know, just take one, like it'll help you with your ears. It was something I never felt before. It was, gave me energy, like I was super mom, I could take care of my kid. Larry had tried heroin before. He told me it was the exact same thing, a little stronger, but it was half the price. So I thought, why not? My addiction got so bad to where one day we didn't have money. And Larry knew of the guys around the corner. It was a tire shop, Mexican guys. Mm-hmm. He made a deal with one of the guys. Go upstairs, take care of one of the workers, give us money. So I did it. Larry and I got in a fight. He would hit me if I was sick and couldn't perform. Get a knock on the door. Child services at my door. They're coming to take my baby. So I had to sit there and watch these people come in and take my baby away from me. We just separate. I was staying in abandoned houses. I met this guy. He kind of sold me a dream. And then it just switched. I would have to beg for tampons. I would have to beg for a water. I wasn't even a person. I met a couple and I did dates with the wife. I ended up getting an infection in my leg. And at this point, I couldn't even move my leg. I couldn't even go to the bathroom. But yeah, I was still performing dates. He was still setting up these dates. He would just kind of cover up my leg. Deep down, I'm screaming, I'm crying, I'm dead. I'm nothing inside, I am dark. There is no colors in my world. So my father comes to my house, never been there before, didn't even know where I lived, had no clue. My brother tells him where I lived. So he comes over, doesn't even knock, just walks right in. And I mean, I've seen him get teary-eyed, but I've never seen him cry. And he's like, Jen, you're going to the hospital. Puddles of infection were just running, dripping down my leg. Emergency surgery. The infection was just on the right leg, but they had to do surgery on my left leg too, where it was just spreading. I feel like I'm taking my body back. My drug's not controlling my body, I'm controlling my body. So when you graduate Catch, you become a butterfly. So that kind of represents Catch, you know, the fact that I graduated. I found love. So that's definitely something I never thought would happen. We were friends first. He accepted my story. There is good men out there. You can find love after trauma and after everything.
Este es el hogar donde vive Melissa. Es parte de su etapa final de recuperación con Catch.
I came in February.
How long do you guys normally stay here for?
There's no deadline.
Okay.
As long as you're active and trying to, like, build your life up and continue to, you know, accomplish your goals. And I mean, this isn't where you want to be forever, but this is like the step before you get your own house. I mean, there's so many women that, I mean, don't know how to pay bills, don't know what it is to get a money order, don't know what it is to wake themselves up on their own. Mm-hmm. Like, it sounds crazy, but that's something I struggle with.
Yeah.
Just waking up, having that self-control to get up. There's four of us that live here. We split the bills. There's a little bit of structure, but really, you're fully responsible for yourself. You live in your own house, and that's pretty much it. Molly, did you shut these off?
No.
Are you sure? When you blow-dried your hair?
I took out the strainer, but I plugged it back up. You have to hold it down.
They're both was shut off.
Why didn't I?
Ouch. Never mind, they're already hot again.
Melissa ahora es una cristiana devota, como sus compañeras de casa. Se están preparando para ir a la iglesia.
My church family is like a main part of my foundation. You know, I'm connected through them, not just on Sunday.
It is so hot out here.
I'm just grateful to be able to know what it's like to pay a bill, to know what it's like to get a paycheck, even though sometimes it's like, dang, man, like I worked all week, and that's it. But then instead of that's it, like, you know, like, I'm a responsible, strong, independent woman today, and a productive member of society, which I never thought that I could be. I'll be driving in my car and I'll just start crying, like, thank you, God. I can say today I know what it's like to have a good man, to be treated right. When you're spiritually connected, with or without anybody, I still love me. Some days are emotional, you know, these feelings still come up, even things that you work through, they still come up. But God has placed all the people in my life that when I can't lift myself up, I have so many people around me. I have a foundation, a firm foundation, and that's what it takes, that's what you need to be able to continue to succeed in life.
Para quienes participan del programa Catch, esta es una noche de celebración. 900 de quienes participan son de Columbus. Estas sobrevivientes han superado sus peores momentos y es difícil no sentir el optimismo que ahora moldea su futuro. Lentamente, las viejas definiciones de tráfico sexual se van desvaneciendo gracias a los casos de alto perfil. Todavía hay mucho camino por hacer en cuanto a prevención y sentencias, pero reconocer y tratar a las sobrevivientes es un paso en la dirección correcta.